This is part 13 of Blazor tutorial. In this video, we'll learn what is repository pattern, benefits of it, and finally, an example that uses repository pattern to store and retrieve data from a SQL Server database. What is a repository pattern? Well, repository pattern is an abstraction of the data access layer. It hides the details of how exactly the data is saved or retrieved from the underlying data source. The details of how the data is stored and retrieved is in the respective repository. For example, you may have a repository that stores and retrieves data from an in-memory collection. You may have another repository that stores and retrieves data from a database like SQL Server, yet another repository that stores and retrieves data from an XML file. Let's understand what this all means with an example. We want the Blazor application that we are building as part of this course to be able to perform CRUD operations, that is, create, read, update, and delete against employee objects. Notice this interface right here, iEmployee repository, contains methods that perform the respective CRUD operations. Consider this first method, getEmployees. This method returns us the list of all employees, that is, iEnumerable of employee objects. We made this method return a task because we want this method to be async. And the same is true for the rest of the methods here. This method, getEmployee, returns employee by ID. We pass it the ID of the employee whose details we want as a parameter, and this method returns that respective employee. AddEmployee adds a new employee, update updates, and delete deletes. This interface is the abstraction, and we'll be programming against this interface. This means just by looking at this interface, we cannot really tell where will the employee objects be retrieved from or stored. Will they be retrieved from an underlying database, an XML file, or an in-memory collection? These are the implementation details, and they will be present in the respective repository implementation. So the point that I'm trying to make is the interface in the repository pattern specifies what operations, that is, methods, are supported by the repository. We only specify the data required for each of the operations, that is, the parameters that need to be passed to the method and the data the method returns. As you can see, the repository interface contains what it can do, but not how it does what it can do. The implementation details are in the respective repository class that implements this repository interface. If we take a look at the project we've been working with, notice in the models folder of our API project, I've already included this repository interface, iEmployee repository. Our obvious next step is to provide implementation for this repository. We want to store and retrieve employees from a SQL Server database, and this specific implementation of the repository is going to do exactly that. Notice our class, employee repository, implements the interface iEmployee repository, and the first thing that we're going to do here is inject our application specific DB context class, app DB context class, into this employee repository using the constructor. We implemented this class in our previous video, and it knows how to work with an underlying SQL Server database, and you can find this class in the same models folder. So we are injecting this application specific DB context class into our employee repository using dependency injection. And if you're new to dependency injection, we discussed it in detail in part 19 of our ASP.NET Core tutorial for beginners course. We have the implementation for getEmployees method. Notice this method doesn't take any parameters and returns us an iEnumerable of employee objects, that is, the list of all employees. Getting the list of all employees is straightforward. On the injected app DB context instance, we have the employees property that returns us the list of all employees from the SQL Server database table employees. Similarly, we have to provide implementation for the rest of the methods, that is, get, add, update, and delete employee. I have already added the class file employeerepository.cs to the models folder. We want this class to provide the implementation for the repository interface iEmployee repository. Next, we need an instance of our application DB context class to be injected into this employee repository. So let's include a constructor first. Our application DB context class is appDBContext. Let's call the parameter appDBContext and generate the required private field by pressing Control period. First, let's provide the implementation for addEmployee method. We want this to be an async method. To add a new employee on the injected appDBContext instance, we have employees property, and on that we have addAsync method, and to this method we pass the incoming employee object. Since this is an async method, let's await its execution and store the result in a variable called result. Next, we need to call saveChanges on the appDBContext instance. Again, we have saveChanges async, so let's use that and await this method's execution. And finally, we want to return the added employee object. So on the result, we have entity property, which is going to return us the added employee object. Let's close this solution explorer to get a bit more room. Let's make this delete employee method also async. And here is the implementation. We have a red squiggly under first or default async. That's because this method is present in Microsoft.entity framework code namespace. So let's bring that in. And the implementation is straightforward. First, we are using the incoming employee ID to retrieve that respective employee from the database using appDBContext. If we have found the employee, we are removing that employee and then calling saveChanges async method on the appDBContext instance. Next, get employee. First, let's make this async. And here is the implementation. Just one line of code here. Use this incoming employee ID to retrieve the respective employee. Next, we have get employees. Again, let's make this async first. This method doesn't take any parameters and returns the list of all employees. Finally, update employee. To update an employee, we first retrieve the existing employee object from the database using this incoming employee object employee ID. If we have found the employee, we then override all the properties of the employee object we have retrieved from the database using this incoming employee object properties, and then call saveChanges and return the updated employee object. Just like employee repository, we need another repository to manage employee departments. We are not going to create, update, or delete departments. We just need two methods here. A method that returns us the list of all departments and a method that returns department by ID. Here's the implementation. Department repository class implements the interface iDepartmentRepository, and to this repository class we are injecting our application DB context class using the constructor, and then we have the method that returns us the list of all departments from the SQL Server database, and this method returns the department by ID. To the models folder of our API project, I've already added iDepartmentRepository interface and the implementation. Finally, we need to tie the repository interface and the implementation classes together. We do this in the configure services method of the startup class. With these two lines of code here, ASP.NET Core provides an instance of department repository class when an instance of iDepartment repository is requested. Similarly, an instance of employee repository class is provided when an instance of iEmployee repository is requested. At the moment, we are using addScoped method to tie the repository interfaces and the implementation classes together. In addition to addScoped, we also have addTransient and addSingleton methods. We discussed the difference between these methods in detail in part 44 of our ASP.NET Core tutorial course. I have already included the code that we have seen just on the slide in configure services method of the startup class of our API project. With this code in place, throughout our entire application, wherever iEmployee repository is injected, an instance of employee repository class will be provided. Later, if we want to swap this employee repository implementation with a new implementation, all we need to change is this one line of code. Instead of using employee repository class here, we use our new implementation class. What are the benefits of a repository pattern? Well, there are many. The code is cleaner, easier to reuse and maintain. It enables us to create loosely coupled systems. For example, if we want our application to work with Oracle instead of SQL Server database, all we need to do is implement an Oracle repository that knows how to read and write to Oracle database, and then tie this new Oracle repository implementation with the interface iEmployee repository. In an unit testing project, it is easy to mock and replace a real repository with a fake implementation. That's it in this video. Thank you for listening.
One thing.